Good evening, this is What's Going On. I'm John Lee. Our guest this evening is Barbara Upchur, a member of the Davis School Board of Trustees. Barbara, I want to thank you for being on our show.
Thank you for having me.
For sure.
Pleased to be here.
For sure. So we're going to talk about the school board and Davis politics and how it all fits together, and you're in the middle of it. So why don't you just start out with an overview of the school board politics?
Sure. Well, I'm a relatively new member of the school board. I was elected in November 2014, so I've been on the board for 18 months. I was sworn in December 2014. I love it. I love my service on the school board. It's, you know, a big commitment. We meet every other Thursday for many hours, sometimes more than others. And we go to a lot of community events. As a matter of fact, last week we were part of four graduations in town, and I have another graduation tomorrow night. We have the Davis High graduation, DaVinci Charter Academy, Davis School for Independent Study, King High, and then tomorrow night the Davis Adult School. And so I wrote five different speeches for five different graduations and was happy to do it. Doesn't bother me.
Well, when you said you go visit other places, that's your hometown. I mean, that's your home turf. That's the victories. That's the success of the whole program, is getting to go to graduation.
It is. It's one of the happiest times of the year and we haven't really had a huge part in graduating these kids. It's really the teachers who have done the work, and the students and the families who have done the work. But it is a real nice cap to the year to see these students going into the world, whatever they might be doing, whether they're going on to their careers or to college. The happiness of that night is really contagious, and it's just, you know, really great to see these young people growing up and having, hopefully gotten a lot out of Davis schools.
I know people that went to UC that think that Davis High was harder.
I have heard that too, actually.
So I've also heard that there's a lower third and a middle third in Davis, just like there is every place else. And people have to succeed in school. It doesn't happen automatically. It's hard work.
Yeah, that's true. I think that we like to, you know, talk about the kids who take all the AP classes and who, you know, get into MIT. But we do have a lot of different types of students. As evidenced by all those programs that I just referenced, we really need a path for everyone, a fit for everyone. And I think that's an area where we can do better, is helping kids on all different paths thrive, not just the traditionally good student.
So the big headline news is you just hired a new superintendent. So why don't you talk about
Sure.
him, and then talk about the relationship between the superintendent and the board.
Wonderful. So yes, we just hired Dr. John Bowes as our new superintendent. He starts July 1st. All five of the trustees are thrilled with his hiring. The process was, we did use a search firm for the superintendent search, because we in DJUSD are not equipped to do an executive search of that magnitude. The search firm was one that was really steeped in education. It's run by a number of former superintendents. It was the search firm that we used when we did the search for our previous superintendent, James Hammond. They did a great job. They did a wonderful job getting us all the information we needed to make a good decision. And Dr. Bowes just hit it out of the park. He wowed us in the first interview. He wowed us in the second interview. And we couldn't be more thrilled that he's coming on board. He has a classroom teaching background. He's bilingual. He has had administrative experience in a large district and a smaller district. His district he's coming from right now is a bit like Davis, a little wealthier than Davis. It's Rancho Palos Verdes in Southern California. So I think that he will be a great fit for Davis, both from his educational philosophy and his personal philosophy. I think, you know, he talked to us about what he wants to do with technology, what he wants to do with education. and the fact that we in Davis have great schools, but we can be even better. And we believe that, I think we do as a board, that, you know, we don't wanna rest on our laurels. We wanna be even better than we are now.
Well, you got new kids coming every September, August.
Sure do.
You gotta start over and it's a whole new year and you got a whole new set of challenges.
Yeah, no, you're right about that. Each year brings its own set of challenges, and I think that that's another reason why I believe our new superintendent will be very successful in Davis. He seems to me to be very proactive, a forward thinker, a strategic thinker, an educational leader, and I think he can handle whatever might come along.
So talk about the relationship between the superintendent and the board.
Yeah, it's a very interesting relationship. People assume that we're the boss of the district, which is not true at all. We are policymakers. The one employee who reports to us is the superintendent. But we have to be very careful as board members not to get into the weeds. You know, we don't talk about the broken fence at the school.
Right.
That's not our role. It's not that we don't care about it. It's just that we are supposed to take a 40,000 foot view and talk about what we want our district to be overall, what policies can help make our district the best. And so our superintendent is really our link to policies, procedures, and culture in our district. And so typically each trustee will meet with the superintendent once per week. And the board president, who this year is Madhavi Sunder, next year usually the vice president becomes the president. We just take turns.
Right.
It's not the top vote getter. It's
right.
We just take turns on the school board. And so the board president will meet with the superintendent to set the agenda for the meeting. And really, though, the superintendent, you know, is the educational leader of our district. The buck stops with him or her. And so that's our, you know, relationship in a nutshell.
So I never really got to talk to Wilford, the most recent.
Oh, yeah.
But I got to be really good friends with James Hammond.
Yes.
And James Hammond had a major impact on our community.
Yes, he did. I worked with Dr. Hammond on the Superintendent's Parents Advisory Committee. I was PTA president at that time and worked with him closely. I thought he was a great superintendent. Now, you know, he is the highest paid superintendent in the state of California. I don't know if you knew that.
Well.
he's moved to a much larger district than Davis. Winfred Roberson was a very able, kind, man, he was with us for 6 years. I don't know if you know this.
I know a little.
The average superintendency in the state of California is about 3 years. So people jump in this industry.
Sure.
And so, you know, we would love someone who could stay with us for as long as possible. And Winfred stayed with us for 6 years,
right,
like I say.
Right.
So Dr. Bose has a 4-year contract, and we hope that
he'll get an extension.
That he will get an extension and stay with us as long as possible.
Well, we had Bob Trigg as our superintendent for a year, and then Elk Grove stole him, and they added 4 new schools and a new high school every year for like the 20 years after that. And then he became the head of the state school board. So we've had some great superintendents. Sometimes it doesn't work out, but sometimes it's fabulous, and that's what Davis is that we attract people and you have the responsibility of holding them accountable.
Yeah, exactly. You know, the board does an evaluation each year for the superintendent. We work closely with that person, and you know, it's people joke that it's hard to be a superintendent because you have a 5-headed boss. And so I think Winfred was successful in making us all feel like we were all heard, and he did not play favorites. And I think that is real key to a successful relationship between a superintendent and a board. Lots of humor, lots of, you know, frank conversation. Those are all really important
Yes.
Qualities to have in a relationship between board and superintendent.
So how'd you get involved in school politics, and tell us about your kids, because I think that's part of school.
Yeah. So education became my passion issue in maybe a weird way. I don't know. Maybe a lot of parents pick education as their passion issue once they have kids in school. But I remember before I had kids, I read an article in the San Francisco Chronicle about two side-by-side districts, one in Oakland and one in Piedmont. And Piedmont's school had all the money in the world because of fundraising. And they had a new science lab, and they allowed their PTA to fund positions. And 3 miles down the road, this school in Oakland was falling apart. They had no money raised. They had no science labs. They had peeling paint. And I said, what is going on in the state of California? I mean, I knew what was going on, having lived in California since Prop 13 had passed, having been a student in California since the sixth grade. But I read that article, and it really started me thinking about how do we fund education. But I was younger at the time, didn't have children. When my children started going to school, I started realizing, wow, you know, they need the parents to pay for the Kleenex, and they need the parents to pay for pencils and markers and field trips, and they really are having a tough time. And so that's when I started getting involved in PTA. And so I have three children. I have a junior in high school, a son. He goes to Davis High, and I have twins, a boy and a girl, who are 14, and they will be ninth graders at Emerson. And I should say that my high school son, he'll be a senior. So he was a junior this last year. So when the school year starts, I'll have a senior and two freshmen.
Graduation was last week.
I know.
You have a senior and two freshmen.
Right.
They aren't in last year. They're in next year.
They're in next year.
Yes.
That's right.
Congratulations.
Yes. Thank you.
Another one.
So when my first child entered kindergarten, I started volunteering in the classroom. I started seeing firsthand the challenges that the teachers faced. And at that point, we were actually at a really small class size. My oldest son's class size was 22-1. But of course, that went by the wayside when we hit the recession. And so I continued to volunteer in classrooms. Working with different teachers taught me a lot. Taught me a lot about classroom management. Sure. Taught me a lot about parenting, to be honest.
Sure.
Because they're experts. They're, you know, I think every parent has, you know, their test cases or their, you know, sample set of 2, 3, 1 kid. But teachers, you know, have had
120 if they're in high school.
Hundreds, thousands,
yeah.
You know, of children over their career. So I really observed them keenly when I was in the classroom. So I became PTA president at the school, and the PTA president is, you know, you're running a 501c3. Most of the PTAs,
a tax exempt nonprofit organization.
Yes, you are. So you're responsible for those rules, you're responsible for PTA rules, you're, you know, responsible for between $30,000 and $50,000 in terms of a budget. You're also responsible for talking to parents about what their needs are, what their concerns are. So it was really good training for being a board member. And then after that, I was on the school site council at Willett Elementary. Each school site gets a very small amount of money from the state through the district to administer and to, you know, pay for things on campus. And so that was another interesting assignment for 2 years. That was an elected position. And then in 2012, I co-chaired the parcel tax because I knew a lot about school funding. I knew what we were facing, and I ran a full-out campaign with my friend Lori Duesenberg, who's now the president of Davis Schools Foundation, for the Measure C campaign. It was successful. We passed that with 73% of the vote. And so when it came time to think about running for school board, even as outgoing as I am, I was humbled. I was, boy, I didn't know if I had the courage to do it. Because you put a lot of yourself out there. Especially in Davis. I mean, we're a very engaged community, and you better be able to hold your own in this community if you decide to put yourself out there in a public way. So I thought about it for a long while, and I decided if I didn't do it, I would regret it, because I had at that point 10 years of volunteer leadership experience in the district. I knew a lot about how the district ran. I knew a lot about how the district was financed, and I thought that it would be irresponsible not to run given the knowledge that I had. And also, I thought that my skill set lent itself well to being an elected official, because I'm not shy, as you noticed. And I like talking to people, I like hearing their stories, I like helping people.
So how has it turned out compared to what you expected?
Well, it's interesting. I think that I knew the time commitment. If anyone knew or had their eyes wide open, it was me, because I'd gone to board meetings for many, many years. I had friends who were board members, and I knew that they had a tremendous time commitment. But just like anything else, you never know until you're really in it. And so I think that, the when you're living through the time commitment, yeah, it's a lot. It's a big commitment. I mean, I'm totally up for it, and I really, you know, enjoy serving in this way. I think that I was a little bit surprised about how the community can engage you. I probably shouldn't have been. And you get all comments.
You mean being on the other side?
Well, you get all comments. I mean, you get very positive comments.
Right,
you get very negative comments. You get very personal comments. And so, you know, you have to have a pretty thick skin. And so I've been developing that. I'm probably not all the way there yet. But, you know, I'm trying to do the best job I can for students.
You don't want to get all thick skin.
No, you got to have a little heart left.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the heart's there, but being able to get to it, you want to be able to open your, you know what I'm saying, you understand.
I can access it pretty well.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
So, how are your kids doing in school?
They're doing fine. I think
it's a loaded question.
It's a little weird for them, you know, having their mom on school board. I think I try to really keep what I do very separate from what they do. I mean, my parent hat is different than my school board hat. But even though my kids actually have different last name than me, everybody knows that I'm their mom.
Yeah.
And so. You know, I'm very cautious about my interactions with my kids' schools. I don't want any misinterpretations. And they're old enough now, and this is part of the reason I waited to run. I thought about running prior, but I wanted to wait until they were self-sufficient enough be doing their thing.
Sure.
And at 17 and 14, they can fight a lot of their own battles. They're responsible enough to do their own thing, and that's the way that it should be. I don't have a problem, you know, if there ever were to be an issue, I'm sure I could approach it in a respectful way. But, you know, we need to be cautious about how we work with administrators and teachers at all times.
So there's some real good reasons why she was so articulate in that, and her name's Nancy Peterson. We had a problem with a school board member who confused those two things.
Yes, yes.
And she had to resign from the board, and it was a very controversial thing. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, it was. I think that was a very unfortunate situation, but it was also kind of a reminder to those of us who came after about how you need to act.
Right.
As an elected official, as a parent who has children in the schools. And so I think we all realize how it needs to go.
Well, in the city, it's weird because it's property. If you own property, then you can't make a decision that affects the area around that property. But within the school board, the property, the thing that matters, are your kids.
Oh, sure.
And so when you call a teacher, do you go, "This is Barbara Archer," and she goes, "Oh, the school board member." You don't say the school board member because she knows, but...
Right, so yeah, you've got to be careful. I mean, I still feel like I can advocate for my children, but you have to do it in a respectful way that talks about them, not about you,
well,
and what they need. Because, you know, that's what the teachers want. for all kids.
Hopefully.
They want to be able to do their best job for each student. And so it's just all how you approach it.
Hopefully you're so successful at that, that when it's your kid that's on the line, your role model for how other parents can be effective in being successful with their kid.
Of course, they would never know because it's all done in private. But
well, but that is the point. I mean, the part of what you do to advocate for your kid is just have the teacher hear your point of view.
Yeah, and the way I look at it is we're partners in education. We really are. I mean, before I ran, I remember, you know, a teacher asking me, hey, can you come back in a little bit? I need a little bit more support with your student. Or, you know, I might need some help. Like, hey, you know, what do you think about this? And so that's the way I look at it. I look at it as a partnership, whether I'm a school board member or not.
Sure.
But like I say, I'm always cautious.
But again, I think it's because you're successful that you're a role model for other parents in how to be effective in being advocates for their child.
I hope so.
And that you're modeling that when you're up there on the board.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, being in public life, you know, I mean, it's not like we're celebrities or anything, but we, you know, we are, you know, out there at all times. Yeah. I mean, my kids will joke when we go into the Nugget parking lot. They're like, all right, get ready. And, you know, they're fine with it. But, you know, a lot of people want to engage you and they want to talk to you. And that's part of the deal.
But celebrity is having the image without the substance. You have the substance and the responsibility for the image.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I do look on it as a great responsibility because, you know, if you're not respected in your community and you are, you know, acting, you know, silly or using your position in a strange way, you can't be an effective policymaker. I mean, it's just done at that point. So to preserve your ability to be an effective policymaker, well, first of all, I think you just need to have respect for the office and really love what you do. And then maybe a lot of it just comes from that. But yeah, you just have to make sure that you're you know, cautious and thoughtful and intentional in your actions.
At the risk of being subtle, we have a presidential nominee.
You subtle?
We have a presidential nominee who doesn't understand what you just said.
That's true.
I was subtle.
Yeah, that's pretty subtle.
Yeah.
They will look back on this in the historical archives and not know who you mean.
Yeah, well, I good luck, Hillary. I mean, Trump is going to do a lot to abuse whatever that responsibility is that goes with being an elected office or even being a nominee.
Yeah.
Where the country is going through a major earthquake because of that.
Yeah, oh, I think so. I mean, I watch the news or, you know, listen to the radio or go online every day just to hear what's said.
Well, the Chinese say, may you live in interesting times.
No, we do.
We certainly are. So let's talk about what you do during the day. What's your day job?
So my day job is I'm the public relations manager for Farm Fresh to You, which is a CSA, community supported agriculture business and produce delivery service. So we, our company delivers produce to homes throughout the state of California. And it started as a smaller company, but now, as I say, delivers to thousands of homes throughout the state. So my job is to basically get good press for this wonderful company that I work for. And it's not hard to do, I'll tell you. I have an easy job. I have a great spokesperson I work with in the owner of the company. He's a natural, media savvy person. Even having grown up on a farm, it's just he's natural at it. And it's a great story. It's a family business. It is, you know, about healthy eating. It's about sustainable agriculture. It's about sustainable communities. So I will have worked there 6 years in August. It's the longest I've worked anywhere. I'm a jumper normally, get bored, jump, you know, off to doing something else. I've been in PR my entire career. I started in book publishing. I worked for Harper & Row, which became HarperCollins Publishers. I worked in high tech in a number of capacities. And then I took a 5-year hiatus from work because my older son was 2 when the twins were born. So I needed to get my sea legs after having 3 children in 2 years. And plus the childcare money alone would have killed me. So when the twins went to preschool, I went back to work. And I did some editorial work at UC Davis for a short time, and then I started working for Farm Fresh to You. And that office is located in West Sacramento, and it's a wonderful job. I love going to work every day.
So I don't have a way to ask this as a question, so I'll just say it. The Farm Fresh for You is part of the KPA Organics?
Yeah, we have 2 brands, so I'm in charge of telling 2 brand stories. KP Organic is the name of the farm. It's celebrating its 40th anniversary this year. It started as a farm to start the Davis Farmers Market. And that's the kind of the funny part about how the farm started. The company right now is owned by 3 brothers, and John knows the story, but I'll repeat it.
Please, that's what I tried to get you to do.
But it was founded by Martin Barnes and Kathleen Barsotti in 1976. Martin was a community development student at UC Davis, and he wanted to change the food system and had this idea to start a farmer's market with some other farm, you know, knowledgeable families. And then he thought, oh no, what if nobody comes? So I better grow something. And so that's how the KP Organic brand started. And today, 40 years later, KP Organic has sales stalls at you know, farmers market stands at 16 farmers markets in Northern California. We sell to restaurants, wholesalers. So you'll see, you know, our product in everywhere from Whole Foods to Mulvaney's to Grange to a, you know, nice restaurant in San Francisco to Byright in San Francisco. So that's the KPA Organic brand. And then Farm Fresh to You is the home delivery brand that delivers right to your doorstep, which is a different CSA model than many. But Kathleen started the brand like that from the beginning. She really wanted to make it easy. And she thought, you know, a way to change the food system, make it as easy as possible, give them as much choice as possible, because everyone's trained that we go to the grocery store for food. A lot of kids think that's where food comes from, is the grocery store. And then they come to our farm and go, oh, I didn't realize this is how food was grown. So we do a lot of outreach to young people. We have farm tours for students. We have festivals at our farm. We host monthly farm tours because we want to get people out to the land that grows their food. So it's really great. I like working in food and ag much more than hawking hard drives in high tech.
Somehow high tech is not very sustainable.
No, it's not sustainable.
Or
and it's not, yeah, it's kind of boring. I mean, you know, I mean, I'm thinking about this one media tour I did years ago for this kind of set-top box that was, you know, a hard drive and all is an all-in-one hard drive and server. And it was just the most boring media tour ever. But, you know, I went on it and I did it and whatever. But now, I mean, I am talking every day about something that can change people's lives. I'm talking about something that can change their community by conserving natural resources, by not using pesticides. I'm talking about something that can change their health. And so, you know, it really makes us all, I mean, I'm not alone in this. All my coworkers feel this way, that we are working for the betterment of society. I mean, it sounds corny, but that's how we feel.
Well, I just have to be sentimental for 1 minute here. I spent one night on the farm. It's up in the Cape Valley. It was 33 years ago. It was right the day I changed my name. So Martin Barnes was the first person I told that I changed my name.
Oh, what do you know?
Back up in the Cape Valley. So can you go visit the farm?
Oh, yeah. I was just there yesterday, as a matter of fact. I had a really great day. This is an example.
So you're an employee. Can somebody from the public come and visit the farm?
Well, yes and no. So you can make an appointment for a tour.
Good.
But mostly the way people come visit the farm is they come to our festivals. So we have the 3 big festivals. We have Cape Tomato, Cape in July. We have Cape Crush in September. And we have Cinco de Mayo in May. We have March, April, August, and October farm tours. So we have all those opportunities. We have the school tours too. And then also if you know me, then you can make an appointment with me and come out there.
So if they want to visit the farm, they can look at the website.
And they can see the event calendar, and we encourage them to come out. It's a really fun day for the whole family.
So either KPA Organic or Farm Fresh.
We have two websites, kpaorganic.com and farmfreshtou.com.
Good.
Yes. So my day on the farm yesterday, we like giving back at our company. And so I have had the pleasure of working with a teacher in the Washington Unified School District, which is West Sacramento. She is starting an ag program there. She's gonna teach ag bio. She's gonna teach a course she's calling Farm to Fork. She's gonna start the FFA program there, Future Farmers of America. And they also have a new $20 million culinary facility in West Sacramento that they constructed through a bond. And so instead of, they still have auto shop for career technical ed or wood shop, but they also have a culinary track students who want to be trained as chefs and then go into the work world. So it's really a signature accomplishment in our region. So she called me up and says, listen, I want to make sure I'm telling my students, what the reality is out there.
The truth.
Yeah, and that, they think of ag as someone who rides a tractor. So we spent all day together on the farm yesterday. She was meeting everybody who basically does, all the different jobs that are done on the farm. And then we spent today in West Sacramento with our marketing group, our IT group, with our procurement group. And then tomorrow, she's gonna come and we're gonna go in our packing warehouse, and she's gonna spend also time with our customer service, because she wants to go back to her students and say, hey, these are all the opportunities that are available for you. Here are some of the skills that you need to get a job in today's workforce. And so it's been a really inspirational thing, getting to know her and hopefully contributing to students' knowledge. So I'm allowed to take 3 days out of my week to do that. And to me, that's a big deal, that they would say, yeah, this is worthwhile. This is a one way that we can give back, to our local area.
Because you've vertically integrated the food supply system from the planting all the way to the fork.
Right.
You have the ability to identify each of the job roles as they relate to the track that the food goes through from beginning to end.
Well, and as always, when you do an exercise like that with someone, you end up learning a lot too. I mean, I've been with this company for 6 years, and yesterday I learned stuff at the farm I didn't know that's gonna help me do my job better, because my coworkers out there told me some things they hadn't had the opportunity to tell me. So it was a really great day.
Well,
and it wasn't that hot.
Your job, well, it wasn't that hot, and it was June. I mean, that's unusual.
I know.
You're in the position of articulating what they learned. You're the person that's the mouthpiece for the better you can do of explaining who they are and what they do, the more effective you can be and they can be.
Yeah. So, I can't wait to, work with this school district ongoing, as the years go by, as their program develops. And who knows, maybe we'll have some graduates from that program come
work
with the company.
Absolutely.
Makes sense.
Absolutely. I mean, internships and
yeah,
you can figure out ways that high school kids can get work credit.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there are lots of things that you can work with that teacher in West Sac and then maybe do one in Davis too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, I'm the liaison for Davis Farm to School on the school board. I have a lot of, each of us gets committee assignments, and I should be, kind of, right? So that's one of the subcommittees I enjoy serving on. I'm also on the Davis Teachers Association 2x2. I'm on the city 2x2.
Yeah.
So once a month, two school board members meet with two city council members. Once a month, two school board members meet with two representatives from Davis Teachers Association. So those are really fun assignments I enjoy.
So I'm going to change the subject now slightly.
Okay.
And then we'll get back to school board politics. So we just had a city council election. The city council has a new group that's going to start on the 1st of July. And they're talking about a new general plan, and I'm advocating that Davis become a charter city. A quarter of the cities in California are charter cities. A general law city like Davis has certain authority, but a general law city does not have as much authority and responsibility as a charter city can have. 9 of the 10 UC campus cities are charter cities. Davis is the only one that's not a charter city. So the difference between doing a general plan as a charter city is you can do more things, you can talk about more things. 25 years ago, we talked about doing a new general plan, and I contributed some ideas that led to our having a group on youth, a group on seniors, a group on computers, a group on economic development, a group on health, and a group on social services. That's in addition to the mandated state elements that are in housing, transportation, and land use. Unfortunately, after we went through a 3-year process with 300 people, all the stuff that wasn't mandated got thrown out. So the general plan that we wrote 25 years ago really doesn't have anything about innovation in it. What I'm proposing now is that Davis go through a charter process in the next year. I've divided the city of Davis into 12 communities, so it's kind of like 2 or 3 communities would serve each elementary school. 4 or 5 communities would serve each junior high. But the point is that everybody lives in a part of Davis, not in the whole thing. And so the idea that I'm proposing is that we do a process where we involve people in their community and then do the citywide stuff as a result. So I have a bunch of ideas. I've been presenting them to the city council. And this week I'm presenting the compilation of all of them. This is called the Davis, California Charter City Community Building Handbook. And I've been presenting it to the city council over the past 6 months. This is a proposal for Davis to actually lead the way in the 21st century. Most of our institutions were designed before World War II. Most of them are real old and slow. So the budget is actually looking at last year. It's not looking at next year. It's driving by using a rear view mirror. If we're going to go into the future in the 21st century, we're going to have to deal with some problems in some new ways. I have a lot of ideas about that. Many of them do not fit in the general plan, and they were eliminated 25 years ago. I've been very patient about this, but I have a lot of things that I want to talk about. This is about community being involved. This is not about the experts and the bureaucrats. We need to have a youth group. We need to have a seniors group. We need to have kids from every school talk about the future of Davis. It doesn't matter when people over 50 talk about the future because they're living in the future. The future for people under 50 is somewhere in the out there. We need to talk about that. I hope that you'll engage in that discussion. The good news is the PTAs are the center of that discussion. That's the end of what I wanted to say. The PTAs, that's our training ground for getting people involved in the community.
It's one of them, that's for sure. I mean, there's a lot of ways to get involved for sure. PTA does an amazing job, and booster clubs alike, you know, doing enrichment activities for children in our schools.
Actually, I'm talking about the parents at this point. The good news is we have a lot of parents like your parent, you, that when your children were in elementary school, you become engaged.
Yes.
We have a lot less parents that become engaged at the junior high and even less that become engaged except for grad night. And grad night is, but the great thing about Davis is when you go to DPNS with your kid who's 3 or 4 years old, you're meeting the parents that you're going to be calling for the next 12 or 13 years.
Boy, isn't that the truth? Yeah, it's amazing. I was thinking a lot about that because when I was giving my graduation speech, especially at Davis High, well, but at other schools too, I, you know, started seeing the graduates come across the stage, and you know, their kids that, you know, I've known a lot of their lives, and I've known their parents, and we were in baby playgroups together, and you know, here they are, you know, almost adults. So yeah, I mean, it does come full circle, those relationships that you make, you know, early in parenting.
Well, what holds society together is moms calling between 6 o'clock in the morning and 10 o'clock at night to get their kid to wherever tomorrow is. I mean,
and these days dads too, of course.
Well, I'll believe that when I see it. I mean,
you know, we have a lot of men involved in PTA. The PTA that I was president
of. I'm begging for it.
We've had three male presidents during, you know, the time I was involved with that school. So I think, you know, a lot of men are very involved in their kids' lives and schooling.
The other thing I want to argue for, since I'm doing it, is having parents engaged in the classroom like you were.
Yeah. Oh, it's a gift to the parent. And like I say, you learn good parenting tips too.
But it also means, especially if you're working with somebody besides your own child, that they get individualized attention.
They get individual attention, or, you know, one program that we have through Davis Farm to School is the gardening program, where the parent will take 10 students out of the classroom, teach them a little science lesson that is in the garden, but the classroom teacher has time to work with a smaller amount of students on mathematics or reading.
Right.
And so, you know, it's not just about the garden lesson, it's also about lowering that, you know, student to teacher ratio.
Exactly.
Yeah, and that's, you know, invaluable.
The student's more likely to learn if they get the positive and negative feedback. You've got to have both to be able to grow.
No, that's for sure. You need guidance of all types.
So back to political reality.
Yes, I love political reality.
Well, that's why you're here. So three or four issues that the school district is confronting now that you need to wrestle with in the next 6 months?
Well, that is easy to talk about because we've planned for it. We had a retreat last year as a board. We identified our two top priorities. We didn't know at the time that our superintendent would be leaving, but our two top priorities at that time were examining the achievement gap and trying to close it, and passage of the parcel tax.
So
those are our two top priorities, and then now we'll be onboarding. That's a very buzzword type of, you know,
You
word.
Just made it up.
No, I didn't make it up.
Oh, okay.
I've read it in education journals. And so we'll be onboarding a new superintendent, and you know, I think we'll be, you know, talking, you know, as a board with him about, and he'll be talking to us about what are our expectations of our relationship, how will we roll that out, you know, what are our goals, you know, with him for the next year. So that's a project for sure, and something we're very happy to engage in. And then the passage of the parcel tax, as you know, we will have a parcel tax on the ballot in November for the presidential election. We are still deliberating as to how much that parcel tax will be. And we are meeting on the 28th and the 29th of this month to decide exactly that. We're gonna have a special morning meeting on, I think it's like 8 o'clock in the morning on the 28th. And then I believe our meeting on the 29th is at regular time, but you'll have to double check. You can go to the district website.
So normally the district, the vacation block is in July.
That's correct. We're in recess in July.
Where the city is in August.
Yeah, I believe so.
You know, Paris and most of the rest of the world is in August, but the school district has to be going full speed.
That's
in
right.
August.
Our school starts in August.
You got to be ready in August.
We have to be hiring teachers in August,
You have to be ready for the kids.
We have to be ready for the kids. We have to hire all the teachers we need to hire, and so we need to be there to vote on those hires in August. So yeah, July is our month when we hopefully take a deep breath and re-energize and recharge for the next school year. I think that, those are the issues that we're going to be working on the next 6 months. With regard to the achievement gap, we've already started work on that.
So wait. Mm-hmm. Let's pretend like I don't know anything about what the achievement gap means.
Okay. So yeah, that's another kind of education buzz phrase. So the achievement gap to me means that we have some students who don't perform as well in school as others. And this is seen in standardized testing, but it's also seen in graduation rates. It's also seen in participation in extracurriculars. And typically, it is students who fall into a lower socioeconomic status. Their parents may have a lower level of education. And so how do we reach those students? How do we identify potential in those students? How do we not only identify it, but grow it? And so that's what we're looking at. And we've had a number of presentations to the board about how different schools are addressing the achievement gap. And so it's an ongoing discussion, but then comes the analysis part. Okay, we've been doing this, and this works. We know this works. But really, I think increasingly, we need to get better at looking at data to see what works. And so it's a big challenge for us. I mean, I think it's very possible to help kids better who fall through the cracks. It just, it is and it has to be.
It's also the biggest problem with the education system by definition. I mean, the whole point of the education is to earn the A, which means you achieved.
I don't know if necessarily it's earn the A.
But, yeah.
But it's, yeah, to do well in the class.
To understand, to be able to handle the problem, to be able to do the math.
Right.
To be able to recognize the chemistry, to be able to see the point in time in history and understand what it meant.
Right. And so I think, you know, we have work to do. Like I said, you know, we have a lot of great things about our district, and we know our strengths, but it takes a lot of courage to look at the areas where you have some weakness or some room for improvement and really focus on that.
Right.
And no one's interested in resting on our laurels. We could do that very easily in our great district, but what we want to do is make our district even better by making sure that we are helping all students.
Sometimes the B does a story about Davis that's bad. Sometimes they do a story that's good. Usually that's about education. When either, you know, at the university or in K through 12, this is a long time ago, but the B did a study of all the high school districts. Davis didn't come out first in any one of them. They came out second in every single one. The number of UC, you know, the number of graduates that went to UC, the scores on the SAT, the number of people that went on to PhDs, any kind of criteria you want, within the education system, we have enormous standards. We have high expectations every year. And it's because the hardest class in Davis High School is the second year biology class. Because most of the kids' mothers have PhDs in biology. And so when you come into class the next day, they go, "My mom said you were wrong." And the mom knows more about what the teacher was teaching than the teacher does. And you have that every year in every school, in every class.
Well, and like I said, you know, obviously we want to challenge those students, but those students are being served and doing well.
They're going to do just fine.
And they're going to do just fine.
Yeah.
I mean, not to say that we shouldn't have offerings for them and we shouldn't offer them curriculum that challenges them. We should. But we also need to look at the students who are not achieving at grade level. And this doesn't mean just high school. This also means elementary.
Especially
elementary.
If you don't have your math and reading skills, how can you do the rest?
There's no foundation from which to build. So, yeah, we have to look at it at the earliest grades.
My philosophy is the teacher's job is to bring the C student up to the B level. With the DNF student, you have a whole different set of problems. But the B student should do the work. The A student should say, give me more, give me more. I was coaching a girl in algebra, and she said, I have to do every single one of the problems in the homework to be able to understand the lesson. And I said, the book was designed for you. You're a perfect success of the book. Most people have to go through the problems and then think about it and figure it out.
Yeah.
That's what learning is. Those are the achievements that we ask kids to make every day in school.
Yeah, no, we do ask a lot of our kids, and of course ask a lot of the kids. But I think too, you know, these days they also, you know, they have a lot on their minds. Life is stressful, and they have a lot of activities, and so you know, I think we need to learn about a healthy dose of balance, and try to model that for our kids. You know, that's just my two cents. I there's no real policy, I suppose, that goes along with that, but. But yeah, I mean, so really, you know, in summary, you know, working with our new superintendent in his first year, passage of the parcel tax, and analyzing how we can close the achievement gap, those are our top priorities.
I want to thank you for being on our show.
Oh, are we done already?
If you want.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
See, I told you I was chatty.
Yeah, well, I knew it wasn't going to be really hard to do, so... Thanks for serving on the school board.
It's my pleasure.
So this is a subtle recruitment for people to run for the school board and the city council. Rochelle Swanson and Rob Davis are now the next two retiring members of the city council. They've made really clear they're not going to be running in 2018. If you're interested in the Davis City Council or the Davis School Board, we need people to run. We need people to learn about the city. We need people to learn about the school board. We need people to help people run. People like Brett Lee were elected because they work really hard and because people like Barbara worked for Brett Lee. And I want to acknowledge Brett for the work that he's done in the campaign, which I thought was extraordinary. I want to thank you for being on our show. This is what's going on. Good evening.